Welcome to the Manage Impact Development Training for Operations Manager. My name is Brian Wren, and I'm a knowledge engineer with Microsoft, focusing on System Center and cloud technologies. This module is titled Creating a Manage Impact Solution. In this module, we'll create a solution with multiple projects using Visual Studio authoring extensions for our Manage Impact. We'll use this solution through the rest of the training to create the different Manage Impact elements that we'll be working with. By the end of the training, we'll have a completely functional Manage Impact. Before we do that, though, let's have a look at the sample application that we're going to build a Manage Impact for. This is actually a sample that we've used for a few years at conferences and trainings, and it served us well, so we made some updates to it to illustrate some newer concepts. The application doesn't actually exist. We wanted something that would be very easy to simulate in your own environment without any kind of installation requirements. That way we can focus on the Manage Impact concepts and not have to worry about some application setup. Basically, we'll use existing services and other components to simulate the components of the application. Event create utility to create test events, that sort of thing. And we'll just create our own registry settings to drive our discoveries. The concept of the application is a point of sale system supporting retail stores. We have some components in a central data center and a server and point of sale clients located at each store. When an order is taken at a client, it's cached on the local server and then sent to a central server in the data center. The central server maintains a queue for each of the retail outlets. Each order is stored in the queue before it's written to the database. We'll do some monitoring of those queues using folders and text files to simulate orders. Not entirely realistic, but it's an easy way for us to provide some error conditions and some performance information that we can monitor. And it'll certainly provide some good support for monitoring scripts, which we'll spend a pretty healthy amount of time on. Now, adding to that basic functionality, we have some web servers that allow external customers to access their orders, and we have some batch processing being performed by a Linux server. We'll hold off dealing with that one for a while, but we'll provide monitoring for that when we spend an entire module on discovering and monitoring for Linux. Everything I've defined here as running on-premise, in the stores themselves and in a data center. But once we've gotten all that monitoring working, we'll have a look at doing some customization with the Azure Manage Impact. Basically, we'll look at how our monitoring would change if we move some of these components into the cloud. So this is the basic application we're going to be working with, and I'll define various details about the discovery and monitoring requirements as we get to those different sections. So here we are in Visual Studio. We can go ahead and create ourselves a solution in the different projects that we need to build the Manage Impact for the application I just described. So notice here I do have an option for a project from an existing Manage Impact. This is not what we're going to do, but I'll just talk to it briefly. Basically, what this allows us to do is import an existing XML file, an existing Manage Impact, into Visual Studio. What it'll do is take the entire set of XML from that MP file and bring it into one very large MP fragment in Visual Studio. Then, of course, you can go and break things up as you choose to and build your project how you want. But that's a way that you can import an existing file into Visual Studio and start editing it that way. In this case, though, I'm just going to say a new project. And you can see here's Manage Impact for Operations Manager. I have the VSAE installed on this workstation. You see that I have three different options here. Now, in this case, I'm going to start with an R2 Manage Impact. What we're going to do is create three different MP files. In the case of the Manage Impact for the application I just described, I'm going to create one MP file for discovery. Basically, I'm going to define the classes and discoveries and split things up in the way that I described earlier in the previous module, how we're going to break up the service model from the health model. Now, technically speaking, the Manage Impact we're going to create really isn't big enough to justify that sort of thing. But I want to do it for the sake of the training because I think it will illustrate quite a few concepts. So we're going to create a discovery MP file, we're going to create a monitoring MP file, then we're going to create another file for dashboards. And so for the discovery MP file, I'm going to go ahead and select an R2 Manage Impact. That will create it with the original schema. No features that the 2012 schema is going to provide to me, so I'm going to go ahead and do it in R2, meaning it can install in any version of Operations Manager. Now, just to talk to the other two, as you see, we also have 2012 and 2012 SP1. Both of those options will create an MP file with the new schema. It's the identical schema. What the SP1 option does is it basically creates references to the SP1 versions of the library files, Microsoft Windows Library, System Library. And so that way you can validate the operation against those newer files. So in this case, I'm just going to select R2 Manage Impact. My location is directory I have for my management packs, and MP author is the folder I'm going to use. And in this case, for this file, this project, I'm going to call mpauthor.stores.discovery. That will be the name of the project. For the solution, I'm just going to call mpauthor.stores because that's going to hold the different files that I talked about. So I'm going to go ahead and say OK there. And this will create our solution as well as this first project. So we can see here's our solution. Here's our discovery project, and you can see the references that got created for us. These are just standard libraries that we're going to need in NEMP. We will need to create some other references later on. I won't bother doing that now, but when we come to some other capabilities that we're going to add in, we're going to need to add references to other library management packs. But just to quickly have a look at one of these, if we look at the properties here, I'll go ahead and dock that. You can see that it actually is picking this up from a folder that's included with the VS authoring extensions. And basically, the product ships with the different library files that you need. You may need to pull down other MP files for other management packs that you reference. And what these are required for, obviously, these are the MPs that need to be installed in the management group when we install our management pack. But while we're doing authoring, we need to also have access to the MP files on disk so that we can get definitions of the different elements that we're going to use. And again, that will become a little more obvious later on. So at this point, though, let's have a look at the properties for this project, and we'll basically walk through each of these and talk to them. First is just the ID and the name. Now, this actually isn't the display name as it references here, and we're going to create a display name in a moment for it. And we can see that we're just going to start with version 1.0 here. So next one, now we want to say, what are we going to do when we build this management pack? So the Visual Studio, unlike the authoring console works with the entire set of XML. Basically, you're just saving right back to the XML file. In Visual Studio, though, we're actually treating this as our source code. So we're going to break things up. We're going to have different MP fragments. We're going to have templates. We're going to have all these resources. And then when we're actually ready to generate our XML file, we're going to go ahead and do a build. So what this is asking here is, when we do that build, do we want to seal the management pack or not? And in this case, we are going to do that. Let's go ahead and generate a sealed management pack. Now, to do that, we're going to need to provide some information. Company name, I'm just going to call this MP author. Obviously, you would use your actual company name in there. I'm not going to worry too much about my copyright. And then we need a key file. Now, this is pretty well documented in the MP authoring guide, but I'll walk through the process here. It's pretty straightforward. We're going to go ahead and generate ourselves a key file that we can use. And so this is just a command prompt, the developer command prompt, that installs with Visual Studio. This is not just standard Windows command prompt. This sets up other paths for me. And we see the SN utility. And this is the strong name utility that Visual Studio ships with. And the one option that we're going to want here is dash K, which generates a new key pair and writes it to an output file. So all I'm going to do here is say SN dash K. I'm going to call my key file MP author. And it's as simple as that. Now, what I want to do is put that in a folder where I store my management packs for MP author. So it's pretty simple as that. We can see the key pair is written. Now I'll go over there and have a look, and we can see if I go on my MP author folder here, here is the actual file that we just created. And this is a key pair that we can now use in order to seal our management packs. So what I could do here is go ahead and browse to that file. I could go ahead and select it. And this would completely work. Basically, when we do the build, it's going to generate the XML file. It's going to go out to this folder on disk, and it's going to get the key pair to do the sealing process. What I'm going to do, though, is something a little more that I find a little more efficient. I'm actually going to add that file to the project. So I'm going to say add existing item. I'm going to go over to that folder there. I'll say all files. And I'm going to add that. Now that it's in my project, I can remove the path. And what this does is basically the key pair can follow around my project. Now, in a heavy security environment, this is probably not the way you're going to go, because you're going to secure that key file in a lot more stringent basis. In my case, this is completely for my own test purposes, for my lab purposes. When we actually generate the final management pack that would ship, we have a separate key pair that we keep very secure, and we go through a little bit of a different sealing process there. For the case of my testing environment and my development, though, this works out great for me. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. Next is we look at our management group. Now in this case, I have one management group. I already have it defined. This is just the name of a management server. And what this says is we can actually, after we build our solution, I can have it automatically deploy out there to an existing management group, which is actually a very useful thing to do. That's what we'll do throughout the training. So I'm going to go ahead and leave mine in place there. That's the name of my management server that I'll be connecting to. Obviously, you could just say add here, would add a server name, provide credentials, and set things up for your own environment. And of course, we can have multiple management groups defined because certainly it's different environments that you might work in. Last, we're going to look at deployment and a few different items that we're going to set here. We're starting with version 1, and we're going to say to go ahead and auto-increment. What that means is every time I build this project, it's going to increment the version for me. Again, something very useful for us to do. Start action says if I actually click start here, basically to run a program, Visual Studio, what I'm going to have it do is automatically deploy. All right, we could say do nothing. In other words, just build, and then we'll deploy manually. And you can see we have other options there. We can have it deploy and automatically start the operations console for us. I find really the most efficient way is I make some changes to a management pack. I can just do start. We do a build and automatically deploys out so I can do my testing. So I'm going to go ahead and keep that option there. And then last says which we're going to deploy. Again, I'm just going to go with this option here that says the startup project only. Right now we only have one project. When we create a couple others in here, one will be designated as a startup, and we can change that very easily. Alternatively, I can actually say I want you to deploy all of them. Anytime I run start, I want you to update all of the MP files there. I like to control things a little bit more, so I'll just go one at a time. So anyway, that management pack is set to go, all properties set on it. The one thing I want to do at this point, though, is give it a display name. And so if we were to install this management pack now, and we went to the administration pane in the operations console, we would see this listed as mpauthor.stores. I'd kind of like to give it a nicer name than that, or I should say mpauthor.stores.discovery is how this file would be listed. And I'd kind of like a friendlier name without the dots in it. So what I'm going to do is go ahead and add a manage pack fragment. I'm going to say add new item. And I'll say MTMP fragment. We're going to do quite a few MP fragments throughout the training. This one I'm just going to call it project, which really just represents some top level definitions for the project. And I'll go ahead and add that. We can see this is empty. And I'm not going to go too much into detail about the XML structure here. All we're going to do is add a display string, and we're going to be adding a whole variety of display string for different elements. If you notice here, if I just hit this left brace, I get a listing of all of the different XML elements that are allowed at this level. So basically, it's only going to provide me with top-level elements at this point. So I'm going to say language packs. Go ahead and finish that. And then if I do the brace again, it says you've only got one option under language packs, which is to create a language pack. And in order to get the attributes, all I do is hit space. And I know for language pack, I need to set an ID. ENU is United States English, and I'll go ahead and set that as is default, true. So this might look a little bit cryptic to you, but we're pretty much going to see this little section in every MP fragment that we write, because we're going to need to provide display strings for the different elements in that fragment. So if it looks a little bit cryptic, this is something you're going to get very used to. And I'm going to say display strings. And I just need one display string in this case. It's going to be the element ID is mpauthor.stores.discovery. And the name, and in here, this is where I'm actually going to give it the display name that's going to show up, mpauthor.stores.discovery. Basically, I'm just using the same thing without the dots, which is a little friendlier to read. So again, something we're going to see quite a bit for other manager pack elements. And so I'm going to go ahead and save that, and I'll close it. basically, we're ready to go with this project. This one is done. It's ready for us to start building, in this case, the service model and different elements we're going to put in there. But while we're here, let's go ahead and create those two other MP files that I need. And there's some other settings and some other options that we're going to want to talk to. So I'm going to say add. This is a new project into the existing solution. I'm going to stay with the R2. I don't need the 2012 schema for this one. I'm going to call this mpauthor.stores.monitoring. And I'm going to do same things I did before. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to add my key pair into there. Oh, I have to select all files. And that goes in there. Let's go ahead and set our properties. Build. We're going to do a sealed management pack. My company name is mpauthor. mpauthor.snk is the key pair. My management group. Actually, something that I forgot to do on the last one is set that to the default. In fact, let's go ahead. While we're here, I'll go back over to my other project. And I'll set that. We do need one as the default. When we start, basically, it's going to send it to the default management group. Save that one back in Discovery, where I forgot to do that. Okay, so this is monitoring. Deployment, I'm good. We're going to send to the default management group. And we're going to do startup project only. And I'm going to go ahead and do the same thing for display name. I'm going to do MTMP fragment. I'll give it the same name, project. These are two different projects, so we're going to keep these files separate. It's not a problem having the same name. And actually, let's do something a little different. I'm just going to go over to the other one, copy the entire thing out. This is one of the real big advantages of working with Visual Studio, is while we are having to deal with XML and some things, maybe we're lacking a little bit of UI, the ability to just copy paste and do quick editing is really very, very efficient. So in this case, it's monitoring. MP stores monitoring. Okay, and so now I have these two projects are ready to go. Now the last one I want to create at this point is one to hold our dashboards. So remember, I created these as R2 schema. Dashboards were a new feature that were introduced in 2012. And we're not going to create dashboards for several lessons from now. But let's go ahead and set up the project so we can see what just a little bit of difference in creating one for 2012. And there really is very little difference. I just want the option to select it. And then once we do this, we're going to have to set up some references for ourselves. So we're going to go ahead and say 2012 management pack at this point. I'm going to say mpauthor.stores.dashboards. And we're now set up here. And there's really, as you see, there's very little difference. Really the only one, as you see, this visualization library gets added as a reference. And what that's for, that actually holds all of the different components that we use in dashboards. So that really is the only difference that we can see. What we can as well is if we look here, for instance, at the System Center library, you can just see in the path there that it's coming from OM12. So these are actually different versions. We can look at the version number as well, and we can see these are different versions of the library files that are being used. But other than that, this is exactly the same thing. There's really no difference at all in working with this one. I'm going to go ahead and set the same properties I did before. We'll do a seal management pack, mpauthor, mpauthor.snk. Go ahead and add in the file, existing item. And we'll go ahead and add in the key pair. I'll set that manage group to default and deploy to the default manage pack group. Last thing that I'll do is set up the display string for it. So I'm going to add new item, MTMP fragment. I'll call it project just like I did before. We'll go ahead and do that same copy paste just so we don't have to type where we don't need to. And this is dashboards. And there we go. Now, one other thing we need to do in order just to get everything set up here. Recall how I defined these are going to work. Basically, the discovery manager pack file is going to hold my classes and discoveries, hold my service model. That defines what it is we're going to monitor. The monitoring MP is going to provide monitoring on those classes. It's going to say, how do we tell that all of those objects that we discovered in the service model, how do we tell that they're healthy? And what is different data we want to collect in the whole bit? So we're going to create a variety of workflows on those. In order to do that, the monitoring MP file is going to have a reference to the discovery, because we're going to need to use all of those classes as targets. And so it, and obviously something that we'll see when we get there, but at this point, let's go ahead and set up a reference to it. So if I go into the monitoring MP and I say add a reference, and we can see here, I could browse and go browse off to an MP file. In this case, we have our library files already there, but I might have other MP files that I need to add, and I could browse to those. That could be something that I pulled down out of the catalog or whatever. Any MP file would work as a reference. But in this case, I'm going to select from the existing projects. So in this case, I need the discovery MP. Now, what's nice about this, and it's a service that Visual Studio provides to us, if we notice here, right now it defines the minimum version as 1.0. But as we work with the discovery file here, we're going to be incrementing its version. As we add elements and we test and we do builds, we're going to see the version number for that MP file get incremented. And what will happen automatically for us is when we build the monitoring file, it will actually set the reference to the appropriate version based on the current version of the discovery. So that it's a very nice feature that adds for us. The one thing that I do want to set here is the alias. Now, MSD would work fine. It's just using the initials of the MP file there. But that's really not the easiest thing for me to remember. And it's an alias that I'm going to use throughout the management pack when we refer to those classes. So I'm going to call it stores discovery will be the alias that I choose to use. And same thing over in the dashboards MP is we're going to have to add references. And I'm going to go ahead and add references to the other two. Basically, it says in order to look at dashboards, we need those other two manager packs, the other two manager pack files installed. It's going to refer to classes. It might refer to rules in the monitoring MP. And so it needs those other two to be installed and needs to provide references to them. So I'm going to call it stores discovery and stores monitoring. And so now we actually should be good to go. I'll save everything. And obviously this manager pack does nothing at this point, but it is valid. You actually could install this. And just to do a quick test on it, make sure we have everything in place, I'm gonna go ahead and do a build solution here. And we could see down at the bottom of the screen that the build has started. If I had any errors, they'd come up in my error list, and I guarantee as we go through other elements, we should get some errors along the way. There's pretty much no way I'm going to go through the entire manager pack and not make a mistake, so we'll see that as we go along. In this case, though, you can see the build succeeded, which means our MP files are in place, we have our projects ready to go, we have our references, they have display strings. Again, right now it does absolutely nothing, but we do have a solution ready to go and projects to create our manager pack files. And so basically when we get into our next training module, we'll start talking about classes and service model, and we'll come back into this solution right here and go ahead and start creating elements.